for the second time.
Senate Resolution 1061 by Senator Bullock of the 11th. U.S. Department of Labor urged to recall proposed policies. House Bill 409 by Representative Maddox of the 172nd. Veterinarians, application for license, revised provisions. Through the order, Mr. President.
It is now time for the morning roll call. Time for the morning roll call. Are there any motions to excuse? Senator from the 14th is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. President. Not to break our unanimous record, I ask unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 33rd, supposedly en route.
33rd, without objection, Senator be excused. Senator from the 54th.
I ask unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 9th for business outside the chamber.
Senator from what? 9th. Without objection, Senator from the 9th will be excused. Senator from the 44th is recognized.
Mr. President, I ask for unanimous consent to excuse the Senator from the 43rd.
43rd. Without objection, Senator will be excused. Senator from the 41st is recognized.
Mr. President, I move to excuse the Senator from the 42nd District.
42nd, without objection, Senator will be excused. Are there any other motions to excuse? Senators, please signify your presence by voting the A switch. The Secretary will unlock the machine. Senator from the 56th is recognized to address and recognize some very special guests in the gallery.
Thank you, Mr. President. Fellow senators, are we on? We're on. In the gallery today, we've got Miss Emily Long over here. Not only is she a great mother, school teacher, and wife, but she is one of our newest United States citizens. Welcome. Congratulations, Emily. Please give her a round of applause.
It is now time for our morning devotion. Would ask that senators please take your seats and cease conversation as we prepare our chamber for our morning devotion. We are indeed very, very honored to have a very, very special guest with us today. And to first lead us in our pledge and introduce our chaplain of the day, I call upon the very distinguished senator from the 27th District.
Thank you, Mr. President and members of the Senate. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now to the Georgia flag.
I pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag. To the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation.
Well, good morning. It gives me a great deal of pleasure this morning to bring you the pastor of the day, Dr. Richard Lee. I've known for several years. I've been in Forsyth County for 28 years, and Dr. Lee, they established the First Redeemer Church in Forsyth County 15 years ago in 1996, and this church has grown both in land mass, stature, membership, become a great success in Forsyth County. I asked Dr. Lee what he wanted me to say about him, and I tell you, he's been a pastor for 42 years, and I'm afraid that the list would be longer than what I can read to you this morning. It'd probably take up all of his time. Dr. Lee has with him today, he has his associate pastor, Jeff Jackson, and also Dave Crouch. And I'm not sure whether Dave is the bodyguard or the assistant or what, but I've known Dave a long time as well. But I'd like for you to join me in welcoming Dr. Lee. He's not only a great pastor, he is a author of several books, and he's also a great patriot of Georgia and the United States. Please welcome Dr. Richard Lee, the First Redeemer Church.
Well, thank you, Jack, and good morning to all of you. And thank you, Lieutenant Governor. It was a wonderful day driving in today. There was no traffic. So I don't know what was going on, but I was glad for it. You know, I grew up about two blocks from here. My father was a pastor there for many, many years, and so I'm back downtown where I feel right at home. I got a letter from Agnes. You know Agnes, I'm sure. And she said, you have 5 minutes. I thought miracles still happen. 5 minutes. So today I want to read our devotion from a book that I've written called In God We Still Trust. You know, authors always like to talk about their books. I'm reminded of the story of an author who was bugging his neighbor. And he said, have you read my last book? The neighbor said, I hope so. So this is not my last book today, but I want to read to you from one of the chapters in one of the devotions. And it's the words of Abraham Lincoln. He was president of the nation, and he declared a national day of fasting and prayer. Many of our previous presidents did that. I'm sorry to say that many have not in recent years, but they historically did. Call the nation together to pray and to fast, to do without food and to pray. And this occurred on March the 30th, 1863. And here is what our president said. Listen closely. We have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We as a nation have grown in numbers and wealth and power as no other nation has ever grown. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated and in broken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace. Too proud to pray to the God that made us. It behooves us, then, to humble ourselves before the offended power, to confess our national sins, and to pray for clemency and forgiveness. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, how we love you, and how we are so glad that you tell us that kings and nations are in the palm of your hand. It is not in the strength of men that we trust, or women. It is the strength of an almighty God who has been so benevolent and so kind to us throughout the centuries in this nation. We are indeed the greatest nation in the history of the world, not because of our ingenuity or our wisdom, but because, Father, we have blessed you and you in turn have blessed us. So we want you to know today, it's not upon ourselves that we depend, but upon you. I pray, Father, that you will humble my spirit, and that across America, our spirits will be humbled by the great land that we have. And now, Father, I pray for these men and ladies who make up this Senate of the great state of Georgia, my state. Lord, those of us who pray for them, those of us who lift them up and trust them, may they understand their important role, not only today, and not only for their constituents in their areas, but also for the future, the young people of this state, and yes, the young people of this nation. So we humble ourselves before you today, asking for your help, thanking you for these representatives, and asking that you grant them godly wisdom. And we ask this in the powerful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
If I could ask the senators, please take your seats and cease conversation. We have some very special guests we'd like to recognize. Take just a few moments, if I might. Many of you know Saturday we actually kicked off our Be Healthy Week, in which today continues in that endeavor. And we've got some wonderful individuals that we would like to recognize. Saturday, at the front of the Capitol, we hosted a kilometer run for kids, and we had well over 1,000 individuals participating in it, and it was filled with fun and excitement. And to see the faces and the eyes of those little ones that were eager to get out there and exercise, and putting an emphasis on health and wellness, predominantly to fight childhood obesity. But this week we are focusing on healthy kids and how do we make Georgia a healthier environment for our kids. And today is our High Performance Healthy Schools Day, in which we actually have four recipients, individuals that are doing something very, very special in their schools for their kids to be a high performance school. And as many of you know, the schools that that we're going to be recognizing are four: Arabia Mountain High School in DeKalb County, Crabapple Elementary School in Fulton County, and Springdale Park Elementary in Atlanta Public Schools, and then Savannah Country Day School as well. All of these schools have shown how we can provide students, teachers, and taxpayers with or teachers and taxpayers how a high performance and healthy school can operate with energy, water, and waste efficiencies while supporting student health and superior health quality. By cutting overhead costs, schools can redirect precious financial resources into the classroom, where we all know learning really happens. Especially in these challenging budget times, I applaud the innovation from educational leaders that are taking a proactive step in saving dollars spent on overhead and to instead spend those dollars on improving student achievement. Additionally, these programs give students an opportunity to learn science in a real-life experience and gain practical experience in one of our state's emerging industries. I've had the pleasure of touring many of these schools and can tell you firsthand the programs they are implementing truly make learning more alive. First of all, we have Arabia Mountain High School. It is represented today by their principal, Dr. LaShawn McKellen. This Decatur school, a LEED certified public school, has implemented aggressive programs to reduce energy, water, as well as waste in their schools, and have done a phenomenal job. Secondly, we have Crabapple Elementary School. It's represented by its principal, Mr. George Freeberger. Last year, this Fulton County Energy Star certified public school diversified 32 tons of materials through a recycling program and became a clean air school. Savannah Country Day School is represented today by their principal, Ms. Carrie Vetrovsky. This LEED Silver certified private school has a student population, get this, where over 75% walk, bike, bus, or carpool to school. Additionally, 35% of the food used by the school is grown within a 200-mile radius, reducing costs and supporting the local agricultural community. We also have Springdale Park Elementary School, which is represented by its principal, Ms. Yolanda Brown. And this Atlanta Public LEED Gold Certified School reduced its energy costs by over 18% through an on-site geothermal heat pump, which heats and cools the schools. In every grade, the environmental science standards required in Georgia are taught, applying the scientific method known as the characteristics of science. These schools are actually going and competing nationally to continue in this endeavor, and we wish them very well and applaud their accomplishments. And if you would, please join me in recognizing these four wonderful schools. I also want to take just a moment. We have another individual that is present with us that has been a great, great partner with me. He participated in our Be Healthy Day Saturday. Many of you know him on the football field, plays for the Atlanta Falcons. Normally he leaves people on their back because he is a phenomenal fullback for the Atlanta Falcons, Ovi McGahill. And I want to say that not only is he an individual who is a phenomenal football player, but he spends an enormous amount of his time along with his lovely wife giving back to our youth here in Georgia. Through his foundation, he has worked with schools across the state to support their environmental education, promote physical fitness and healthy lifestyles. And Ovi, we are really honored and privileged to have you here with us and recognize your great accomplishments. We have accommodations for not only the four schools, but also for Ovi as well, recognizing his foundation and the wonderful program and efforts that he has endured to help youth development socially, mentally, and physically across this great state as he promotes healthy lifestyles as well. Please join me in welcoming Ovi McGahill.
I'd first of all like to thank the Lieutenant Governor for inviting me out here to this wonderful event, and say that I'm really honored and humbled to receive, you know, such kind words from you. But I'm very, very impressed by these four schools and what they've accomplished and what they're doing. So can we give them one more round of applause? Uh-huh. And real quickly, part of the reason why I'm so excited about that is because I have a three-year-old daughter, which is my life. She is my heart, my blood, everything. I love her more than anything on this earth. And I want her, when she gets older, she gets, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8, to go to a school like these schools, schools where they care about each other, where they care about the planet, where it's more about, you know, what they can do for others than what they can do for themselves. And it really is going to take all of us. It's going to take the politicians, it's going to take the leaders, the teachers, the principals, everyone who has a chance to really give these kids the tools they need to help us make this world better, to help us, you know, keep our earth cleaner. So we're teaching our kids how to fish, and they're doing a great job. So I just want to thank everyone who's involved in pushing our kids to grow, because my daughter's going to benefit from it, but all of our kids are going to benefit from it. So thank you very much.
Well said. Are there any unanimous consents? We have a consent calendar of privilege resolutions that are before you. Is there objection? Without objection, the privilege resolutions are therefore adopted. Are there any motions to withdraw or commit? Ms. Secretary, are there any filed objections on the local consent calendars?
President, there are no filed objections in the Secretary's office.
Is there objection to agreeing to the report of committee on the state and local governmental operations, which is favorable pass of the bill? Chair hears none. Committee is agreed to. Questions on the pass of the bills on the local consent calendar? All of those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, no. And Secretary will unlock the machine. Local consent calendar. On the passage of the local consent calendar, the yeas are 43 and the nays are 1, and all the bills on the local consent calendar are therefore adopted. If I could have the Senate's attention for just a moment, many of you know that the governor has issued this as Special Olympics Week. And we have some wonderful Olympians that are present with us today. The governor has issued a proclamation that says the Special Olympics organizations provide an important opportunity for young adults and disabilities to experience the joy associated with participating in various sporting events. And whereas Special Olympic Georgia hosts an event with over 23,000 athletes and over 13,000 volunteers, and whereas the athletes in these games participate in a wide range of sports, including aquatic events, track, field, soccer, tennis, and others, whereas the competition gives young adults continuing opportunities to develop physical fitness. They participate in the sharing of gifts, skills, and friendship with their families, other Special Olympic athletes in the community, and whereas the Special Olympics athletes gather, let me win, but if I cannot win, let me be brave in the attempt, embodies the spirit and heart of these athletes and is something from which every Georgian can learn. Now, therefore, I, Nathan Deal, Governor of the State of Georgia, do hereby proclaim May 15th through 20th, 2012, as Special Olympics Week in Georgia, and urge all Georgians to recognize the Special Olympic athletes and their display of skill, courage, and wholesome competition. We have today four wonderful athletes, special athletes with us today. And it's Daley Fitzpatrick, Ashley Perdue, and Kayla Mullins, along with Amber Mullins as well. Please give these wonderful, wonderful athletes and Olympians a round of applause. Secretary will read a resolution.
Senate Resolution 1042 by Senators Davenport of the 44th and others. Resolution recognizing the month of March as African American Business Month at the Capitol and for other purposes. Whereas in 2001, the African American churches, businesses, and community organizations of Atlanta joined to build the Overground RR movement. Whereas, as shown by its name, the ORR is a continuation of the Underground Railroad Freedom Movement, which is aimed at economic freedom instead of physical freedom. Whereas the ORR movement now consists of more than 84 churches, 140 businesses, and 40 community organizations, and is growing daily. Whereas as of 2008, according to the Seelig Center at the University of Georgia, African Americans spent approximately $910 billion, but the gross revenue of African American business was approximately 15% of that amount, which is extraordinarily low in comparison to all other communities. Whereas in his very last speech entitled "I've Been to the Mountaintop," delivered in Memphis, Tennessee on April 3, 1968, the night before his assassination, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. expressly and specifically called on African Americans to unite in their support of their own businesses. Whereas March was chosen because it follows Black History Month and because March 10th marks the birthday of Harriet Tubman, the lead conductor of the Underground Railroad. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Senate that the members of this body commend the work of African American churches, businesses, and community organizations in building the ORR and recognize March as African American Business Month at the Capitol.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. It's my pleasure now to call upon the senator from the 44th to recognize our very special Georgians.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. To my colleagues in the Senate, I am delighted to recognize and to welcome members of the Overground Railroad for all that they do and for this inaugural initiative of March as African American Business Month. You know, in 2001, the African American churches, businesses, and community organizations in Atlanta joined together to build the Overground Railroad. And the Overground Railroad is a continuation of the Underground Railroad Freedom Movement and is aimed at economic freedom. It consists of 84 churches, 140 businesses, and 40 community organizations. And March was chosen because it follows Black History Month in February, and because March the 10th marks the birthday of Harriet Tubman, the lead conductor of the Underground Railroad. So I am so delighted today and commend this Senate for recognizing March as African American Business Month. And we have joining with us today Mr. Harold Alexander, who is president of the Overground Railroad, Reverend Timothy McDonough, who is the senior pastor of First Iconium Baptist Church here in Atlanta, and also the Reverend Albert Love, who is the senior pastor of Boat Rock Baptist Church in Atlanta. And I have my colleagues joining me, the senator from the 38th District, from the 39th district, from the 35th district, and also from the 10th district. And we welcome them and recognize March as African American Business Month. Won't you please join me?
So on behalf of the Overground Railroad and the faith community, Senator Davenport and our other Senate colleagues, and to all of you, we are eternally grateful for this resolution. We want to make sure that the state of Georgia continues to employ and to promote business enterprise, and that's why we are engaged in this. Too many of our young African-American teenagers are unemployed, and we're gonna do something about it. And that's what this effort is all about. So we thank you for this resolution. We will be promoting it through our congregations, and we hope and we pray that it would be something beneficial for our state.
I'd like to call upon the senator from the first to present the doctor of the day.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate, our doctor of the day is Keith Cobb from Savannah, Georgia. He is an internal medicine physician and an author. He is affiliated with South Coast Medical Group and is a clinical assistant professor of medicine. His office serves as a teaching site for medical students and residents from Mercer University School of Medicine and the Medical College of Georgia. He is the author of the Grief Survival Handbook and several medical educational courses. He has appeared on public radio stations and television stations across the country and in Europe, and has been a guest blogger on numerous websites, including the Huffington Post and mariashriver.com. His book was recently picked as a top read by World Magazine. He has served as a lead investigator in several pharmaceutical trials and has researched nicotine cessation, pain management medications, and coping with grief. We are indeed honored to have today as our doctor of the day, Dr. Keith Cobb. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Cobb today.
Thank you. I'm pleased to be with you today. We'll be in the medical station all day, and if we can be of service, please drop by. And thank you for the service you provide to our great state. Thank you.
We have another special Georgian we'd like to recognize, and the Secretary will read a resolution.
Senate Resolution 1020 by Senator Ramsey the 43rd and others. Resolution recognizing and commending Pamela Berger and for other purposes. Whereas Pamela Berger has continuously served the Rockdale County CASA program for 11 years and advocated for over 38 children and their families. Whereas Pamela Berger has served as an advisory board member for Rockdale County CASA and promoted the work of CASA in both the legal and public communities of Rockdale County. Whereas she has assisted in CASA fundraising for four consecutive years and recruited the Rockdale County Bar Association to recognize and assist Rockdale County CASA as part of its Law Day activities. Whereas her limitless devotion, dependability, hard work, and dedication were recognized by Georgia's CASA program through her nominations and awards for CASA Volunteer of the Year in 2005, 2007, and 2011. Whereas in recognition of her amazing commitment to children, families, and safe and healthy households, it is abundantly fitting and proper that the outstanding accomplishments of this remarkable and distinguished Georgian be appropriately recognized. Now therefore be it resolved by the Senate that the members of this body commend Pamela Berger on her selfless and dedicated service to the Rockdale County CASA program, and recognize the tremendous impact her efforts have had upon the state of Georgia.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. It really is a great honor to recognize wonderful Georgians, and I have the ability to pinch hit for the senator from the 53rd, I think, who is not able to be here today to present to you Pamela Berger. Pamela has done something very, very unique and very special in her work with CASA. I think all of you are familiar with the advocacy work that goes on with CASA, and she has given so many of her years, 11 years to be exact, over 11 years of service. But what's amazing is that she's been, because of her service, she's been recognized by Georgia's CASA program through her nomination and awards for CASA Volunteer of the Year in 2005, 2007, along with 2011. That is an amazing accomplishment, and we recognize her great service on behalf of so many wonderful children and families within our state. She is accompanied today by my very famous former assistant, Mildred Slayton, who we brought out of retirement to be here today, and she showed up in my office, and I thought my day was just going to be off the chart because I got to see her pretty face. But it's great to have Mildred here. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Poundberger. All right. Good. Thank you.
Well, this is a surprise. My very best friend Mildred surprised me with this. Court-appointed advocates across Georgia are very important to the health, well-being, and safety for children who become involved in Department of Family and Children's Services. I encourage every one of you to get familiar with your court-appointed advocate program that's run through your juvenile court in each county. This is a very important service. We provide the eyes and ears of the court to the juvenile court judges, and we advocate for the best interests of these children that absolutely do not have a voice of their own. Thank you very much for honoring me today. I had no idea I was even going to be here, so thank you very much.
Well said and well done. That's great. Let's pose for a picture here.
Okay.
Have another special group we would like to recognize at this time. Secretary, we'll read a resolution.
Senate Resolution 1103 by Senator Miller, the 49th, and others. A resolution recognizing and commending Gainesville High School Key Club and for other purposes. Whereas Key Club International is the oldest and largest service program in the world for high school students. Whereas Key Club offers its students members a range of services, including leadership development, study abroad opportunities, vocational guidance, college scholarship opportunities, and a wealth of local service opportunities. Whereas the core values of Key Club are caring, character building, inclusiveness, and leadership. Whereas Key Club has been an integral part of the leadership development program at Gainesville High School for nearly 50 years. Whereas Gainesville High School Key Club consists of over 50 student members and serves a crucial role in leadership development, service opportunities, and cross-cultural social development. Whereas it is abundantly fitting and proper that the accomplishments of this organization be appropriately recognized. Now therefore be it resolved by the Senate that the members of this body commend Key Club for exceptional service to the community and thank its members for their invaluable contributions to Georgia, especially those at Gainesville High School.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? The chair hears none, and the resolution is adopted. It's now my privilege to call upon the Senator from the 49th to recognize these wonderful Georgians for their great accomplishment.
Thank you, Mr. President. As you're well aware, the Key Club is one of the largest and most recognized service organizations for our schools in the entire United States. The Gainesville Key Club has been in existence for over 50 years and has promoted many, many of its members to leadership throughout the state. And this is an exemplary group doing much good for their community. I'd like for you to give them a really warm welcome today. Thank you very much. And just a brief comment from their president.
Hi, we would just like to thank you for having us today. And thank you, Senator Miller.
Yep. Key Club is the oldest and the largest student-run service organization in the world. And Gainesville High School is so pleased to have such a slew of folks that are so excited about service. And thank you again for the recognition.
Well said.
That's exactly right. Absolutely. Good to have y'all.
good to see you. Okay. Let's do a picture down here. Guys, y'all come on.
Moving on to the general calendar, the Secretary will read House Bill 48.
House Bill 48 by Representative Powell, the 171st and others. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 1 of Article 2, Chapter 5 of Title 48 of the OCGA relating to ad valorem tax exemptions and for other purposes. The Senate Committee of the Committee of the Senate on Finance recommends that this bill do pass. Senate Finance Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 48.
Did you pass by substitute?
Okay. Senate Finance Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 48. A bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 1 of Article 2 of Chapter 5 of Title 48 of the OCGA relating to the ad valorem tax exemptions and for other purposes.
Chair recognizes Senator from the 21st. Present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is a bill dealing with Freeport exemption. It simply allows your local governments to place on the ballot a referendum if they want to add a fourth category to Freeport for manufactured goods that are sitting basically on the dock or being waited or waiting on being shipped out of the country. So this is will help your local governments, give them more flexibility if they want to add to their Freeport. I believe it passed the House with only one dissenting vote. If there are no questions, Mr. President, I will yield the well.
There are no questions. Questions on the adoption of committee substitute. Is there objection? Without objection, committee substitute is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection? Agree in the portal committee, which failed to pass the bill. Chair hears none. Portal committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chair hears none. Main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Senator from the 19th. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill will vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 44, the nays are 0, and this bill having CREX constitutional majority is therefore passed. Chair recognizes Senator from the 21st.
Thank you, Mr. President. I ask unanimous consent to move House Bill 110 to the foot of the calendar.
Without objection, bill will be moved to the foot of the calendar. Secretary will read House Bill 175.
House Bill 175 by Representative Cassis of the 103rd and others. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 14 of Article 6 of Chapter 2 of Title 20 of the OCGA relating to other educational programs under the Quality Basic Education Act and for other purposes. The Senate Committee on Education and Youth recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senate Education and Youth Committee offers the following substitute to House Bill 175. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Part 14 of Article 6 of Chapter 2, Title 20 of the OCGA, relating to other educational programs under the Quality Basic Education Act and for other purposes. Senator from the 21st offers the following amendment to Senate Bill to House Bill 175, striking lines 129 through 164.
Chair recognizes Senator 21st. Present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is the Clearinghouse Act, actually a very good piece of legislation. What this allows is if a local system has devised an online teaching technique or an online program, this would allow the state to have a clearinghouse to where all those can be put into one clearinghouse and another system may use it. This will help everybody. A portion of this bill and the substitute includes the Rachel Sackett Act, which we passed out of this body, I believe, on five occasions last year. You'll see an amendment on your desk striking that portion. We don't need to pass that portion out again. So this bill will be clean without the Rachel Sackett Act language in it. That language is still over in the House, and we'll continue to work that from that angle. If there are no questions, Mr. President, I will yield the well.
There is a question. Chair recognizes Senator from the 39th for waves off. Okay, no questions. Speak. No questions.
I yield the well.
Chair recognizes Senator from 33rd. Speak to the bill.
Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, if you'll all take your watches out and see what time it is as I start this morning, and then check them, please, as I close. Make sure I stay within the half hour that I plan to take. And I'm not serious about that. It's good to be it's good to be with you all this morning. The only thing I wanted to say about this is I see some language that refers to special schools and special charter schools. And it gives a special school is defined in paragraph 16 of section 20-2-2062. Guess that's entitled 20. And I haven't read that definition before except in the constitutional amendment proposed for the charter school amendment, and I may be wrong on this, and I'll check with the senator from the 21st. I was going to ask him, but I wanted to say something else too, and that was that so many times some people think that we are against change in our public schools, and we're not. So many of us, we feel like we're not for against change. We've tried to make changes, and of course those changes have been made and stripped and made and stripped, and we have our own opinions about what works and what doesn't. But I happened to be watching 60 Minutes or another news program last night, and I saw an interesting program on the Khan Academy, and it showed I think the gentleman's from Indian descent. He may be a naturalized American. I'm not sure. But he has created a computer program which is getting high marks all around the world. Bill Gates is using it to teach his children, which says something about it being a fairly intelligent process, because he certainly is. And one of the guys that started Google is speaking very highly of this course. It made me think of the senator from the 3rd. And his want, as I said the other day, the proposition has merit, and this is one of those things that I think ties into change in the future as we look at those types of things. And I sincerely meant that the other day when I said we've got great potential in those types of things once we work out details. My only concern about this was because I support the concept of what they were talking about on the news program. It sounded very, very good to me and came pretty well endorsed. But I do have a question about the special schools. I'm going to step down from here and ask the senator from the 21st if he can explain that to me. And I didn't see his amendment when we started talking. I'm sure it's on the desk by now. Thank you, Jim. Striking 121. If you'll give me just 1 second, thank you.
You do have a question when you're done, Senator.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. President. Well, I think I understand. I understand that. That was a controversial area that we've been talking about, and Senator from the 21st feels real strongly about that, and I'm sure we'll get to the point where we're debating that issue, and I do see what he's doing now. And then the only question, at least for me, is the question about special schools and how they're defined, and it very well may be in the code. It's just that our first time I had seen it was in the constitutional amendment, and I just wanted to ask him about that. So I just want to speak highly of the innovative things that are going on, and some of you who are looking at innovative solutions, I don't want you to think our minds are closed to that. They're not. We think there's a way to get there. So I commend all of you who are working on this trail, and hope that we can all end up together at some point in the future.
Chair recognizes Senator 31st for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Does the senator yield?
I do.
When you stepped into the well, you held your watch up and reminded everybody to check their watch. Senator, isn't it true that we just changed to daylight savings time over the weekend?
I experienced that this morning. I did. And,
Senator, do you
I still
yield
think
for,
the world's wrong, but.
You yield for additional question?
I do.
Isn't it true that with daylight savings time every year that we have a number of people who are late to work, lost productivity, increased heart attacks, and increased accident rates as a result of the change to daylight savings time?
Sometimes those people that get old and decrepit and have aches and pains and joints such as I, many people like me have problems sometimes with their tardiness and timeliness. Time management was never my strength. However, I'll submit to you, if you look at the record over the years, I don't think anybody's put any more hours in. Thank you.
The question is on the adoption of the floor amendment authored by the Senator from the 21st. Is there objection? Without objection, amendment number one is adopted. Now the question is on the adoption of committee substitute as amended. Is there objection? Without objection, the committee substitute as amended is adopted. Does any other senator wish to speak for or against the bill? Is there objection agreeing to port of committee which failed to pass the bill? Chairs none, port of committee is agreed to. Shall the main question be now put? Are there any objections? Chairs none, main question is ordered. Shall this bill now pass? Questions on the pass of the bill. All those in favor of the bill vote aye. Those opposed, no. Secretary will unlock the machine. Thank you. On the passage of the bill, the yeas are 48 and the nays are 1. This bill, AMC Rex Constitution Majority, is therefore passed. Secretary will read a resolution as we honor some special Georgians.
Senate Resolution 867 by Senator Mills of the 53rd and others. Resolution congratulating the Heritage High School girls cross country team on winning the 2011 GHSA Class AAA State Championship and for other purposes. Whereas through training, talent, and determination, the Heritage High School girls cross country team earned the top ranking in the state with their win at the 2011 GHSA Class AAA State Championship. Whereas the team of champions included Caitlin Kraft, Mallory Edwards, Mariah Edwards, Jacqueline Alem, Natalie Espinoza Hensley, Emily Poole, Jasmine Sanchez, and Brandy Thompson. Whereas the record-setting 2011 team brought home Heritage High School's first state championship at girls cross country. Whereas the team was driven to succeed by head coach Jeremy Wynn, whose hard work, talent, and dedication are evident in the team's victorious season, which each member displaying character, integrity, and perseverance to obtain this high achievement. Whereas as this magnificent team earned its well-deserved reputation for excellence by performing with courage and precision over months of training and competition, it is abundantly proper to call them champions. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Senate that the members of this body congratulate the Heritage High School's girls cross country team for winning the 2011 GHSA Class AAA State Championship.
Is there objection to adoption of the resolution? Chairs none, and the resolution is adopted. Call upon the distinguished senator from the 53rd to recognize these Georgians.
Thank you, Mr. President. Now, I have the privilege of not only been able to recognize state champs and baseball and softball and cheerleading, but now in cross country team racing. And that is Heritage High School in Catoosa County, the largest high school in the 53rd district. They're among champs in many ways, in education and in sports. But we're glad they're here today. And let me recognize Coach Wynn, which is a perfect name for a winning team. Coach Wynn.
All right. Thank you. Just want to thank each of you. Thank each of you for sharing this moment with us. We really appreciate it. It's a great honor. Real quickly, I just want to kind of recognize their achievement. I'm so proud of a state championship, but I'm even more proud of how they won that state championship. They really ran with their hearts, and they ran for each other, and they ran for a higher purpose. So thank you very much for your time.
Let's also recognize our teammates up in the gallery, too, if they'll stand. Thank you.
Chair recognize Senator from the 40th to recognize some guests in the gallery along with the Senator from the 10th.
Yes. The Senator from the 10th and I would like to recognize the young people from the youth leadership from DeKalb County in the gallery. If you'd all stand, please. Over here. Thank you for being with us today. And over here as well. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
Secretary Reed, House Bill 110.
House Bill 110 by Representative Jacobs of the 80th and others. Bill to be entitled an act to amend Article 1 of Chapter 14 of Title 44 of the OCGA, relating generally to mortgages, conveyances to secure debt and liens, and for other purposes. The Senate Committee on Banking and Financial Institutions recommends that this bill do pass by substitute. Senate Committee on Banking and Financial Institutions offers the following substitute to House Bill 110. Bill to be titled an act to amend Article 1 of Chapter 14 of Title 44 of the OCGA, relating generally to mortgages, conveyances to secure debt and liens, and for other purposes. Senator from the 39th offers the following amendment. Amends the Senate Banking and Financial Institutions Committee substitute to House Bill 110 by inserting after rights on line 6 the following. To provide that any funds received pursuant to a settlement among the states, the federal government, and financial institutions relative to alleged mortgages fraud shall be expended only for the purpose and for other purposes. The Senator from the 10th offers the following amendment. Amend the Senate Banking and Financial Institutions Committee substitute to House Bill 110 by inserting after rights on line 6 the following. To provide that any funds received pursuant to a settlement among the states, the federal government, and financial institutions relative to alleged mortgage fraud shall be expended and for other purposes. The Senator from the 21st offers the following amendment. Amend the Senate Banking and Financial Institutions Committee substitute to House Bill 110 by inserting after any requirements of A on line 46 vacant or.
Chair recognized, Senator from 23rd.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise in support of HB 110. This bill deals with registries for vacant and foreclosed properties. As mayor several years ago, we were confronted with the number one problem of code enforcement, particularly in the area of dilapidated housing and failure of property owners to maintain their properties. One problem that you encounter when trying to code enforce is identifying who owns the property in question. That's not an easy thing to do, particularly when property has been passed down from generation to generation, and we call that heir property, because the ownership is up in the air. In Georgia, the problem has become worse with the recession and the increase in foreclosures. Georgia leads the country in foreclosures, bank failures, and the increasing practice of transferring loans from one bank to another. That has made it difficult to identify who is the current holder of foreclosed property where there are code violations, failure to maintain the properties, draw down, impact the values of other properties in the neighborhood. Now, several localities, local governments have addressed this problem of identifying who to target with code enforcement by requiring registries of foreclosed or vacant properties. These registries are not always uniform, and sometimes the fees charged are excessive. This bill is intended to bring uniformity to the property registration process. That is to identify the key information that counties and cities need to have in order to know who needs the enforcement action brought against. It also limits the amount that can be charged for a property registry to that amount that is reasonably necessary to cover the cost of the registry, and in no event more than $100. The fines are also limited for failure to register. They're capped at $1,000. The provisions set out the definitions of vacant property, foreclosed property, and the information requirements that can be called for in the registry. Mr. President, if there are no further questions, I'll yield the well.
Chair recognized, Senator from 39th.
Will the Senator yield?
Yes.
Senator, I'm looking at page 2, line 30. There's an line 31, as a matter of fact. It says, such term shall not include a building or structure containing multiple units with common ownership that has at least one unit occupied with evidence of utility usage. What is that? What are those lines intended to do, Senator?
That is intended to address a situation where you have a multi-unit residential complex, apartments or condominiums, in which at least one unit is occupied with its utilities connected. There may be other vacant units in the complex, but if one is occupied with utility usage, that would not fall under the definition of vacant property.
Will the Senator further yield?
Yes.
Isn't it true that when you have those situations that you just outlined, that a condominium unit or co-op unit, you know, where you have multiple units unoccupied with one or two or a few occupied, that those unoccupied units can be as aggravating, as problematic, and in need of code enforcement as a single family or residence or other residents, like an apartment complex? Isn't that true? And that exempting them in this way would exacerbate the situation in terms of code enforcement and other impacts?
It wouldn't. The multi-unit properties would still be susceptible to code enforcement. This does not limit any local jurisdiction's powers to enforce codes. It only limits what property owners have to register their properties. And in the case of a apartment complex, the problem of identifying the owner of the complex has not been demonstrated to be necessary for property registration.
Will the Senator further yield?
Yes.
And I understand that. In a situation where you have condo units that are problems, wouldn't the need to identify the property owner be undercut with this language?
Well, let me first point out that it does not apply, that limitation does not apply in the case of foreclosed properties where you might need to have further identification registered in order to know who the owner was. But where you have at least one unit occupied, you know who that person is and generally have a route to easily identify the owner of the overall complex, because that's who the unit holder would be paying rent to. The so that is not a problem that has been identified as in need of a correction.
Will the Senator further yield?
Yes.
On another issue on page 3, line 78 through 83 is the focus of my question, particularly on line 78. It reads, no county or municipal corporation may require registration of vacant or foreclosed real estate property pursuant to this code section within 90 days of such property's real property's transfer. And then there's related language on line 81, which says, to the first subsequent transferee after the vacant real property has been acquired by foreclosure under power of sale pursuant to code section 44-14-160 or acquired pursuant to a deed in lieu of foreclosure. What does that language do?
That gives basically a 90-day grace period in which property owners or holders under a foreclosure would have to come forward and do their registration. it dovetails in with a provision on the same page above that that gives holders of a foreclosure property 60 days to avoid the registry requirements by recording a foreclosure deed or a deed in lieu of foreclosure.
Will the senator further yield?
Yes.
I'm still trying to understand what lines 81 through 83, what those lines do.
Well, that would give the, if a vacant property is sold, it gives the new owner 90 days in which to come in and record it if it still remains vacant.
Will the senator further yield?
Yes.
I have a general policy question. Do you believe that local circumstances and local needs should override this kind of legislation? That is to say, should local control, you know, county by county, would that be better suited to deal with the problem of property registration to the extent that problems in Richmond County or Scriven County or Chatham County might be different from those in Fulton County or DeKalb County? Should this kind of concern be left to the locals?
Well, this leaves code enforcement generally to the discretion of local jurisdictions. What level of maintenance they may require, substantive issues of that nature. But this is a common problem throughout the state of identifying property owners so that code enforcement may proceed. And this just sets out reasonable procedures or requirements for registering the identity of the owners so that code enforcement may proceed. That type of condition would not vary. It is common across the state, and the problem with leaving it to local jurisdictions is you create a hodgepodge of hundreds of potentially differing regulations, which you could be fined for, and sometimes the fines have been excessive. So this is a practical, reasonable approach that, I may add, has received some support from all the stakeholders involved. The realtors have been involved in crafting this. The bankers have been involved in crafting this, as have the GMA and ACCG. So it's a good balance that addresses the problem, gives the locals the information they need without burdening property owners and their agents.
Will the senator further yield?
Yes.
On the issue of the amount of registration, the registration fee, which, if I read the bill correctly, the registration fee is $100. Is that correct?
Correct.
Senator, further yield.
Yes.
Might one county incur greater expense in their county than another county might? Shouldn't that, you know, putting that $100 cap on one county as opposed to another county, isn't that the kind of thing? In effect, this registration fee might not even pay for the reasonable cost that a county or a municipality incurs in creating the property registration. Isn't that true?
I don't think so, Senator. The amount of $100 is reasonable in viewing what would be involved with simply accepting the registration forms, which are very simple, and keeping them in some order where they could be accessed. In the area of real property recording fees, clerks of court around the state do essentially similar tasks for a much lower fee. So $100 gives ample room for local governments, and some may argue it's too high, but it's a fair fee in comparison with what is currently being charged in the majority of jurisdictions.
Will the Senator further yield for one final question?
Yes.
Isn't it true that you just don't know, that I don't know, you don't know, and it could very well, the cost to a municipality or county could very well exceed that $100 cap?
I just don't see that in the cards, Senator. If it turns out that that is too much of a restriction, we can address that later, but I do not foresee that.
Chair, recognize Senator from 27th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Senator yield?
Yes.
Isn't it true that this legislation has been worked on for not only hours but days with various people who had objections or approved of this legislation? Isn't that true?
Absolutely, and as you can testify, it took a lot of work taking into account all the differing interests to come up with a good compromise bill.
And it, with a Senator Father Yield?
Yes.
And isn't it true that GMA, ACCG, the Community Bankers Association, the Georgia Bankers Association, the credit unions have all come together in agreement of this legislation that is now drawn?
You are absolutely correct, Senator.
Okay, and with the Senator Father Yield?
Yes.
Isn't it true that this bill has been pending since our last 2011 session?
That's correct. It was ready to go then, but it's been improved since then, and I think now is the time to move it forward.
Okay, thank you. And will you further yield?
Yes.
Isn't it further true that any senator who had an amendment could have amended this bill, come to the meetings, and brought forth their concerns with this legislation since 2011? Isn't that further true?
Absolutely, Senator. This has been thoroughly vetted, and the only, amendments 1, 2, and 3 have had time to been brought before the process prior to today. And I would point out amendments 1 and 2 are not germane to the purpose of this bill, which is to address property registration. And I would urge that all amendments be defeated.
Okay, thank you very much, Senator.
If there are no further questions.
You do have questions. Chair, recognize Senator from 33rd.
Senator Yield.
Yes.
Senator, this does not affect any property, be owned, rental, investment, whatever, that is occupied. Is that right?
Absolutely. If it's occupied, it's not required to be registered in any manner. I would say that if property is occupied, it's usually easier to find who to enforce the code against.
Chair recognizes Senator from 45th.
Senator Gill.
Yes.
Senator, isn't it true that I appreciate the fact that you have taken this bill under your wing, and I agree with the chairman, you have spent hundreds of hours of working on it. Is that not true?
A lot of time by a lot of people has gone into this bill.
And Senator, isn't it true that I agree with you that amendments number 1 and 2 are not germane? Number 3, there's a little bit of disagreement on that, and I know you haven't had time to look at all these amendments. But amendments number 4 and 5 actually gut the bill. Would you not agree? I mean, I don't know if you've had time to look at these amendments, but in my opinion, they take away all those hundreds of hours that you and the chairman have worked on it. Is that not true?
I'm sure the senator knows of which she speaks, and I would further add that with this bill, the biggest area of problems now is in the area of foreclosures. And some of the registries are 90% foreclosure properties.
Right.
So we are tackling that problem without having to upset existing registries that deal only with vacant properties. If there are any issues that are remaining after this bill passes with those few jurisdictions that have differing registry practices in effect already for vacant properties, we feel confident they will fall in line.
Would the gentleman further yield?
Yes.
Senator, isn't it true in Gwinnett County, which does have a registry, that we have 820 registered properties, and as you stated, there's only about 2% of those that are vacancies? And my question is, since we are number one in the nation with foreclosures almost, we're number one in the state, Gwinnett County's number one in the state in foreclosures, and we're one of the highest in the nation, what would you expect local government to do when their citizens are calling in with complaint after complaint, dozens of complaints about these foreclosed properties? What does the General Assembly expect these local governments to do? How are they supposed to deal with it?
Local governments are approaching this problem in the right manner. It's just we need to make it uniform so that the people who are charged with complying with these registry requirements are not overly burdened and know the requirements that they're charged with complying with. This, I cannot stress how difficult it is to identify ownership of properties sometimes. And some of our real property bar members who are in the Senate could probably also testify that this is a universal problem that is addressed by registries, and we need to make sure the registries are fair and uniform. Mr. President.
Chair and I, Senator from the 51st.
All right.
For question.
Thank you, Mr. President. With a senator to yield?
Yes.
Can you give me your definition of inhabited under the line number 28?
The definition, that's not a defined term. It's part of a definition for vacant properties, and that is property intended for habitation. That is to exclude buildings that are intended for some other purpose, such as storage or conducting a business out of. But if it is intended to be used as a residence, it would fall under the definition. If it's vacant for 60 days and has no utility, water, electricity, whatever, telephone connection.
Will you further yield?
Yes.
My next question was going to be to expand the definition of utility usage. Does that mean that if I don't use any water for a period of 60 days and I haven't lived in that home for the last 60 days, it would be a vacant property?
Well, if you have no utility connections, if you have utility connections, there's going to be some evidence of a minimal usage for most utilities. And that is, when I shut everything off in my house, I still get an electric bill. I don't know why, it just happens.
Will the senator further yield?
Sure.
Have you ever been up to the beautiful mountains of North Georgia in December, January, and February?
A time or two.
Do you agree that the temperatures sometimes get down below 32 degrees up there in the mountains?
Well, not much this year, but in past years.
Thank you. Will you further yield?
Yes.
Is it true that we have a lot of tourists that come up to North Georgia and buy winter homes and summer homes? A lot of people from Florida come up in the summer times and spend 3 or 4 months a year in their homes, and they go back to Florida in the winter months.
For some reason, yes.
Is it further true that most of those people that live here part-time in the summer tend to turn off all their utilities and they disconnect their water lines. They drain the water out of their homes. They turn off the utility systems to their houses so they don't have to incur extra costs while they're not there. And then when they come back in the spring, they turn those utilities back on. Would you agree to that?
I'm sure that varies from person to person, but most people will have something, a cable connection, a light turned on to prevent burglaries, something to show that it is habited.
Thank you, sir. No more questions.
Chair recognizes Senator from 26th.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Senator yield?
Yes.
Senator, does this bill require all vacant properties, rather they are bank-owned foreclosures as well as private vacant properties, to be registered with their local government?
If I understand your question correctly, does it require vacant as well as foreclosed properties? Or can you repeat your question?
Does not this bill require that vacant properties, rather they are bank-owned foreclosures as well as vacant private properties, be registered with their local governments?
It requires any property held under a foreclosure or deed of foreclosure. In the case of vacant properties, it is properties intended for habitation only.
Will Senator further yield?
Yes.
Senator, is it not true that the city of Loganville has this same type of ordinance in effect right now?
I'm sure the Senator knows of that which she speaks.
Thank you, Senator. Will the Senator further yield?
Yes.
Is it not true that the city of Loganville is being sued for this type of legislation?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
Is it not true that the city of Loganville is being sued for this type of legislation?
I'm sure the Senator knows of that which she speaks.
Thank you, sir.
Chair recognizes 27th for a question.
Thank you, Senator. Will you yield?
Yes.
Isn't it true that I own several rental properties?
I'm certain that you do.
And isn't it further true if I own some mountain properties, that if I turn my water off and turn my electricity off and turn my cable off, that it's going to cost me some kind of fee to have all those utilities turned back on if I want to run up to the mountains for a weekend?
I'm sure you're correct. In addition to such other utility services is security alarms.
And would you further agree that wouldn't be too smart?
No, that would not.
Okay. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
Senator, I have Senator from 9th want to ask a question. I don't know whether he's on the floor or not. See if Senator from 9th's in the ante room. You coming? Chair recognizes Senator from the 9th for a question.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Senator yield?
Yes.
The gentleman from the 51st talked about his area of the state. Does this require any counties to have a registry?
Absolutely not. It's still up to each county as to whether they believe they need to have a registry.
So when the Senator from the 51st talks about his area and vacant homes, unless we believe that the county commissioners up there are, well, whatever, I mean, there's no county, is it not true, there's no counties in his district that have a registry right now?
That's right, and nothing in this bill would change that fact.
Thank you.
That's all I have, Senator. Thank you. Senator 23rd, it's all the questions. I'm gonna let you speak, but
okay. No further questions.
You have a question, Senator 33rd? Okay. I know. That's all the questions, sir.
Mr. President, I yield well.
speak to the bill, we call on the senator from the 39th.